to present the most famous words in motorsports is Mary Hellman George, president of the board of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
With those words, Chairman of the Board Mary Hellman George signals what may be remembered as yet another historic day here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, because for the first time in this storied facility's 93-year history, another race will share the stage during the month of May with the famed Indianapolis 500. For more than 80 years, the Indianapolis 500-mile race was the lone event at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. And each year, during the month of May, the track would bustle with activity, only to go back into hibernation until next year. But in 1994, a new tradition was born, as the unmistakable rumble of NASCAR's Winston Cup cars was heard for the first time at 16th and Georgetown. In the year 2000, the Speedway kicked off the new millennium by hosting the U.S. Grand Prix as Formula One's finest raced north across the Speedway's famed yard of bricks. Now, for the first time, the Indianapolis 500 will share the spotlight on racing's grandest stage as the Indy Racing League's Infiniti Pro Series makes its debut here on the world's most famous race course. Today, we'll find out who will be the first to add his name to the list of legends who claim victory here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports, welcomes you to the world's greatest race course, the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, for the inaugural running of the Indy Racing League's Infiniti Pro Series Freedom 100. Hello, everyone. Glad to have you with us. I'm Jerry Punch, along with Indy Racing League veteran analyst Davey Hamilton and our special guest, two-time and defending Indy 500 winner, and again, pole sitter this year for the Indy 500, Elio Castroneves.
Just out of curiosity, did you come up on the steps or did you climb the fence to get up here?
No, I came on the normal way. By the way, it was pretty tough, was it?
A lot of steps.
You say that fence climbing from May 25th. Hey, I got to ask you, millions of youngsters dream over the years of someday coming to this place and racing at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. That dream came true for you 2 years ago. These drivers had that dream realized today. What are they thinking about right now?
That's right. Well, first of all, I don't know what they think. I'm trying to not mess it around here, but I'm sure, first of all, the weather is extremely difficult out there. It's pretty cold out there, and they have to really take it easy on the tires, warm it up pretty well. So hopefully they're going to do a good job. I'm sure they're nervous a little bit to be first time around this place, and this place is very intimidating.
Yeah, and you're 2 for 2 here, so you're batting 1,000. Pretty good job over the years. Davey Hamilton, as far as the track's concerned, what is the primary focus? What do these teams have to overcome for the first time here, these drivers and owners?
Well, I think the first thing that they need to do is, it's a 2.5-mile racetrack. It's the fastest these cars have ever been. It's a very difficult racetrack to pass on, and you have to get your timing down just right, different than some of the most of the racetracks that they race on. So timing and learning how to pass is a key thing today.
The fourth member of our broadcast crew, well, that's Amy Eason. Moments ago, she caught up with our pole sitter, Ed Carpenter.
Thank you, Jerry. And the excitement down here on the grid just prior to taking this green flag is just truly unexplainable, especially for this young man, Ed Carpenter. Ed, you've never captured a pole position in the Pro Series. What a place to wait and do it. The historic Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Truly, what are you feeling right now?
I'm just hoping I can keep it at a weekend at first and go out and get my first win for the whole Futaba Delphi car. I'm just really happy with the AJ4 team. They're doing a great job and learning a lot, and that's what this development series is for. So looking forward to a great race.
Did you get any last-minute advice from AJ?
I'm getting ready to go try to do that right now, so I'm sure he'll just tell me to be patient and run my own race and do a good job.
All right, he's the inaugural pole sitter, Ed Carpenter.
And Amy, a week ago today, he was graduating from college with a degree in marketing at Butler University, and today he is a pole sitter at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. We come back, the IndyCar starts up tomorrow, are set to compete today here on the world's most famous stage. Stay with us back in just a moment. Motor Speedway is being brought to you by Firestone, America's tire since 1900. Getting set for the start at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. History being made. There is Ed Carpenter on the front row alongside Mark Taylor. Foyt Racing and Panther Racing. Taylor, the two-time winner this year in both events. Row two, Simmons and Beardsley. Lion Dyke and Aaron Fock back in row three. Corey Witherill, who ran Indianapolis in the Indy 500 back in 2001, back in row four alongside Tiago Medeiros. They come down side by side, and Billy Gibbons, lead singer for ZZ Top, will wave the green flag in a history-making day at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Speeds approaching 205 miles per hour as you ride along on the Grill to Go Smith & Wesson machine of Ari Lyandike Jr., son of two-time Indy 500 winner Ari Lyandike.
Oh, yellow flag right off.
Heavy contact. Heavy contact on the very first lap of this event.
The whole back of the race car got completely ripped off on that thing.
Made a brave move going inside, but unfortunately, it was a many cars, a lot of cars going on. The air was totally dirty air, so that's what caught him on the accident.
It looks like that would maybe be Corey Witherall in one of the Himmelgarn cars. I think it lost the back of his car.
Hopefully everything's fine now. It's one of those things that right on the first lap, you don't want to do that. You want to take a little time, you know, but unfortunately, that's those situations, you know. You're right there. You wanna pass when you have an opportunity, and things like that happen.
Unfortunately, cold tires. Back to the cold weather that Eli was talking about earlier. You got to be careful, especially on the first lap.
And you know something? The wind is a very strong, especially from back straight to turn one. You know, basically, turn three right now. It's kind of a little loose, as my little experience. I'm still learning out there. So. They have to keep watching those things. Look, as soon as he passed the guy, the guy spun.
There's the replay of the heavy impact. One car spinning. Matt Beardsley involved in the 12 car. Beardsley, the Alpine Bank Old Republic Land Title machine. There's the back, the wing section, and part of the gearbox of Beardsley's car. Developing right in front of him goes low. On board now with Tiago Medeiros, who was swept up into this incident here just moments ago. There's Beardsley's car wiggling, and here comes Tiago.
Boy, you never like to see that. That's a bad view.
Tiago Medeiros, and really, when that happens in front of you, Elio, there's not a whole lot you can do.
Oh, no, not at all. You know, the guy spun. Actually, when he made the pass, he was a little understeer. I believe what happened is he took the air from the back of the car, in front of the car, and Tiago, there is no way. He was on the outside, and the guy starts spinning. That was a shame, you know, because you want to see no accident at all, but things like that always going to happen in racing.
All right, we are under yellow for the first time today on lap number one. Heavy contact involving two cars, Beardsley and Medeiros. Updates when we come back. Back at Indianapolis Motor Speedway, the Grill to Go Smith & Wesson machine of Ari Lyandike Jr. is on pit road, and he has a problem. Smoke billowing from underneath the back of that machine as we are under yellow. Yellow coming out on lap number one as Ari Lyandike Jr.'s car has come to rest. There is Ari Sr. His plans to run this year in Indianapolis were short-circuited after an incident last week, and he was not clear to drive. Let's show you why we're under yellow here. On the very first lap of this event, heavy, heavy impact involving Matt Beardsley and Tiago Medeiros. Riding along with Ari Lyandike Jr.'s on board, and there's Beardsley spinning.
And Tiago, nowhere to go. I mean, you're just long for the ride at that point. When a car in front of you spins like that, and you're already committed to the corner going, you know, excess of 200 miles an hour at that point going into the corner, you just don't have a chance. He just, nowhere to go, and just long for the ride. Thank God neither one of them are hurt at this point.
Yeah, there, I must have to say, there is something that was too early in the race. Obviously, the tires are still a little bit cold, and as I said, the conditions. I think what happened is, in particular that turn, you do have a little more banking. Normally, it's the easiest turn over here in Indianapolis, but depend of the condition of the weather, turn out to be the toughest one. And I guess when Tiago made the pass inside, inside, who was it?
Beardsley.
And you have to understand, guys, I'm new on this thing. You know, normally I'm the one that down there actually making the call, you know.
I tell you, well, let's show the people. These cars are very similar to what you drive in the Indy Racing League IndyCar Series. They are all Dallara's, and they're 3.5 liter V8 engines, horsepower 450 versus about 670 or 700. These have 25 gallon gasoline tanks versus the 35 gallon methanol. They're 3 inches shorter in wheelbase, and the weight a little bit lighter than the car you will drive in the Indy 500 a week from Sunday. So, but they are very, very safe machines, like the cars you guys run on Sunday. You can take that kind of an impact, and the driver's able to walk away and get in the care center units and head over to see Dr. Bach at the Hanna Medical Center. So, Dave, you've been in these cars as well. I mean, and look at these cars up close and personal. They are well built.
Absolutely. Well, the cockpit itself and the tub of the car is basically the same as the Indy Racing League car. They're real wide. They have a lot of, they have headrests just exactly like the Indy Racing League cars. And safety is first and foremost with this series. And so they're made to go these speeds. They're made to hit like this, even though you don't want to.
All right, Ari Leindach Jr. climbing out. Let's check in his pits with Amy East.
Well, he sure is, Dr. Jerry Punch. And what had happened during this caution, a couple of cars came down pit lane, Marco Ciocci and also Ari Leindach Jr. When Ari did come down, the car was on fire. We're getting word now that the alternator caught fire on that car. Ari has climbed out. We'll see if we can get a word from him. Obviously very disappointed. This is not the way that you want to start off the inaugural Pro Series race here at Indianapolis. We'll let him get his helmet off here. He's giving me the one hold on 1 minute sign, so we will definitely do that for him with Smith and Wesson. They got a sponsor on board for this team, Sinden Racing. Ari, you had a little fire there. Alternator caught fire. Was it a result of running over anything in that wreck, or was it just simply a mechanical problem?
Just simply a mechanical problem. We don't know what exactly went wrong, but we had some electrical problems in the morning before qualifying, and we thought we solved them, but, you know, we just haven't had enough luck this year, I guess. Every time we're fast, but something happens, so. Oh, well, you know, I'd like to thank Smith & Wesson.
Moment of this interview, but definitely got a sponsor on board, Smith and Wesson. It was wonderful for them to come on for you guys for this race.
Yeah, Smith and Wesson, I'm glad they came on board. You know, they really helped us out, and Grill to Go stepped up to be the major sponsor. So we had so much support for this race. Just unfortunately, we couldn't do anything with it. I mean, we were fast all week, and it's just disappointing as a driver when the car doesn't work out for you, so.
Okay, well, Ari Leindach is one of our full-time competitors here on the Pro Series. You can bet that they will be back in full force in Pikes Peak in just a few weeks.
All right, thank you, Amy. Ari, a pole sitter last year at Michigan. He finished second 4 times last year in Nashville, Michigan, St. Louis, and Chicago. Still looking for win number one at Infiniti Pro Action. It will not come today. Back in just a moment. And NHRA action coming your way. It's the K&N Filter Super Nationals from the most legendary track on the circuit, Englishtown, New Jersey. Coming your way tonight at 6 o'clock Eastern Time. For more, log on to ESPN.com. We are still under yellow at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. There is Mark Taylor being shown in second spot. Let's check in his pits with Amy East.
Well, a little interesting note on Mark Taylor and the Panther team is there's something to remember about a lot of these Pro Series drivers. Some of them, for example, had never even raced on an oval until the first race at Homestead. That indeed was the case for Mark Taylor. He won that race. He won the following race at Phoenix. So not only is it a special event for him to be on a big 2.5 mile historic oval, this is only the third time ever that he's raced on an oval. Won the first two, feels very confident, especially with the backing of Panther Racing and the advice from Sam Hornish Jr., that he has a strong shot at being in victory lane for the third time this season.
Mark Taylor's background, Amy, thank you. British Formula Ford back in 99. He had two wins and seven top threes in British Formula 3. And it is quite a transition, Elio Castroneves, to come from those road courses to an oval like this, or maybe even a Michigan or even a Texas.
Oh, for sure. I mean, Mark Taylor, for example, he did a couple of, before he started running Formula 3 in England, he did a couple of runs in Brazil with my own team, my ex team over there. And for sure helps a lot, you know. And that's what sometimes people don't understand when the Brazilians are doing so well. It's because when I started with 11 years old, and when I went to a formula like Wings, stuff like that, I was already like 16, and I had some quiet experience, you know, to already understanding about the car. I had my crashes, I had my problems, stuff like that, you know. But all of a sudden, at the end of the day, I was learning, and I'm still learning today. So it's easier to tell the engineers how the car is doing or stuff like that. Especially in this series, it's so equal that basically everybody has the same chassis, and this is very interesting, because when the drivers know how to pick, say, hey, listen, I need less front wing, or the springs are too stiff, that's what make the driver during the long run and improving his career for success.
Well, this series is only 10 months old, and I think that had this series been around a few years ago, it would have afforded people like yourself and others a chance to come run over this. I mean, it basically is a development series for the future stars of the Indy Racing League.
Especially here in Indianapolis, you know, it's such a challenging track, you know, and when you have an opportunity like those guys are having, it's awesome. The 37's having a little trouble. It's kind of tough, you know, for right now, those guys like Thiago, Matt, and Ari having problems like that, because all of a sudden, man, you don't want to have right in the beginning of the race. Have to be in the pits, you know? That's a hard break.
The good part about it is for these drivers, just like down in the NASCAR country where they have a Grand National Series of runs on those Saturdays, and all the big owners are there watching these stars. Here in Indianapolis, they're on the world stage. All the owners, the Roger Penske's, the Kellys, the Ray Hall Letterman, everyone's down there watching these people and saying, you know what? That young man's got a lot of talent.
Absolutely.
I need to keep an eye on him.
Absolutely. You want to do it very well, you know, because everybody's watching. Look, you see A.J. Foyt, fourth, is that right?
Yeah, A.J. the fourth, and Alceo Salazar both there.
They're watching. I'm sure they're giving tips or trying to find who is in a good shape
or not.
They're
just looking to see who's going to take their ride here.
Well, I mean, look what the series did for A.J. Foyt, the fourth. I mean, he had four poles and four wins last year, and his grandpa said, hey, you're far enough along that we can bring you into the Indy Racing League IndyCar Series.
That's true.
And now there's a legendary Super Tex. His grandson qualifies for the Indianapolis 500, and that young man will turn 19 on May 25th on race day. How about being 19 years of age and running your first Indianapolis 500?
Oh, my God. I still like knowing about Indianapolis at 19, you know?
And he's got a tough job ahead of him. I've drove for AJ. I know how that Texan is, and he wants results. I mean, he expects results. He's won this race four times as an owner. He's won it once as four times as a driver, once as an owner.
Right.
And it's his grandson, so obviously he feels that he wants his grandson to do well, but he expects him to do well as well as all the other drivers.
Five-time winner here, four driving himself, once with Kenny Breck just a couple of years ago, a few years back,
right.
and now brings his grandson. The first time in since 1993 that we've got an Andretti, an Unser, and a Foyt in the starting lineup for the Indianapolis 500. So much at stake here. Michael Andretti's final start, his 14th and final Indy 500. The guy to my right here, Elio Castroneves, could become the first driver in Indy history to be to climb three consecutive fences.
Before we climb the fence, first we need to finish. So basically, let's take step by step. And just a quick note here: I believe Billy Rowe, he stepped out of the car, and unfortunately, I believe his day is over. That's one of those deals, you know, Jerry. You don't know. You don't want to. Those things happen right in the beginning. And even for the drivers right now in the car, they don't want to keep going the yellow line, yellow flag. You know, it's. You don't want to make your tires even cooler. The tire pressure is too low. Those situations, it's horrible when you restart the race, because you know if you don't be prepared, something might happen.
Rick Mears, who works with you guys at Penske Racing, is the official driver's coach for this series, and he has helped so many of these drivers, and particularly this week, saying this is a track that can lull you to sleep. You can get very slow, the long straightaways. Is it more difficult to concentrate here than maybe other places because you have the straightaways so long, the turn so long?
Yes, it's so long that you start looking your time, you start looking you take the tear off from your visor, you know, you start talking to the pits, and those situations, it's very difficult because, as I said, this track changed so much, anything might happen, so it's kind of you have to be focused.
And when that thing, they go to a place like Richmond, Virginia, a three-quarter mile track where you don't even have time to look at the gauges. I mean, you're so busy, you're wheel to wheel, you know, you come in, the crew says, well, you know, what RPM were you coming off the corner, or,
that's right,
or what temperature, and they're going to have to tell you because you sure don't have time to look, but here, you're going down, you're looking at the grandstand,
yeah, no,
which
true.
Way the flags are going, and you have a lot of time, and you need to stay, it's hard to stay focused and to really concentrate on what you're doing. You almost need to be out there racing with somebody to keep occupied.
Rick Mears, who has six poles here and four wins, obviously knows a lot about this racetrack. I heard him tell some of the drivers, he said, you have to think fast, but drive slowly. Everything you do has to be very, very slow and
that's
fluid,
true.
Very deliberate.
It's literally it's like that. Let me tell you about Rick Mears. I mean, the guy, believe it or not, 2001, I was the rookie here and end up winning the race. And I guess we're going to go green flag. Here we go. I'll tell you the story later.
All right. Yo, Castro and Nevis, our special guest today at Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Another great start for Ed Carpenter. I mean, he started on the pole, got a lead on the first start. Here's the restart. Really, the first real great flag lap, hopefully, here coming up.
Did you hear the engine? It's flat out. You know, that's why you have to be really careful in those conditions. You have to be on top of it. And right now, the number four, Mark Taylor, he's right on the gearbox. And that's, my God. Jesus.
33, Craig Dolanski up across and noses head first into the wall. The 37-year-old driver from the World of Outlaws series making his very first Infiniti Pro Series start will bring out yellow number two here on lap number 10.
Oh, boy, I tell you, that was a hard hit. You know, you see, thank God they're using those hands device, guys. I tell you, oof, that would be tough.
This guy's been one of the busiest guys this weekend. He's also racing the World Outlaws this weekend. He's been flying back and forth from Charlotte to here and run his World Outlaw car. They're coming back here qualifying this car and back and forth. Matter of fact, they were looking for a replacement for this car in case of rain delay this afternoon. If they had to go tonight, he was looking for a replacement.
Last two nights, he was at Williams Grove. Tonight, he will head to Hagerstown, Maryland, and then Sunday to Grandview, Pennsylvania. And this World of Outlaw driver, third in the points, finished last year behind Steve, the King of the Outlaws, Kinzer, and Danny the Dude, Lasoski, but had a tough one here on lap number 10 as he brings that yellow for the second time today.
I guess he's going to be flying to the hospital right now, at least to check up.
Yeah, he gets to see Dr. Bog, doesn't he?
Oh, boy, and I tell you, doctor, look at that. Let's see what happened. Oh, we couldn't see. Maybe a little. Oh, he's still step on the gas. You know, he couldn't do that. He's still on the gas, and when he get off he should at least let it go.
Just let it go, exactly.
Yeah, that was a shame.
He's trying to save it, and that's probably the normal reaction for a lot of us,
is try to
save the car, but after you do that a few times, you learn just to go ahead and let it go, let it spin out, maybe do a 360 and take off again. These things they're self-starting, so he could have went on, but your normal reaction is to try to correct it and save it.
What I think happened is, again, one of those conditions, a very tough tire pressure, still low, temperature is still low, and what happened, the rear just escaped from his end, and the only thing is start to pray that time.
You know, that was a big hit, actually. They're being very cautious.
And in his defense, when you're a short track driver on the short dirt ovals, that's exactly what you do. You try to save it, and you just continue to try to save it with more throttle and more steering wheel. And here at Indianapolis, you guys said that's not the case. And a tough one for Craig Dolanski bringing that yellow number two. Well, lots of action to come your way tomorrow. It is Indy 500 Bump Day. Our live coverage begins at 1 Eastern time on ESPN, then followed up at 4 Eastern on ABC Sports, and then back on ESPN at 6 o'clock Eastern time for the final 1 hour of Bump Day qualifying as we fill the field for the 87th running of the Indianapolis 500. Back with more from Indy in just a moment. Back at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, we are under a red flag condition due to raindrops that are falling in the area. We've had some sprinkles this morning, which held up practice for quite a while. And there, the Infiniti Pro Series Freedom 100 field being brought down pit road. as we will momentarily halt the action. We were under a yellow anyway, which came out on lap number 11, a very, very hard impact by Craig Delansky, an Indy Racing League Infiniti Pro Series rookie who normally runs in the O'Reilly World of Outlaws Series, and as he had a pretty hard impact with the wall. As we will, they're still cleaning up down there. And let's check in with last year's champion in this series. Amy East has caught up with A.J. Foyt, the fourth.
Well, I sure have, Jerry. Not only was he the Pro Series champion last year, you won four times, four poles. You had seven top 10 finishes, and now that has launched you into the IndyCar Series. Did you used to do that? Did you used to rev your engine right in the middle of an interview? How rude of them. But anyway, tell me so far just your impression of how neat it is for the Pro Series to be here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Oh, it's awesome for these cars to get to come here, and just this is a great speedway, and it'd be awesome to have this race here, and wish it had started this last year so I could have got to run in it. But my grandpa's got a car in it. Ed Carpenter's driving, and he's doing a great job. He's set on the pole for this race, and he's leading right now. Unfortunately, we got some rain, but I think he'll be good, and hopefully see him in victory circle.
Well, the Pro Series have put on some spectacular races over the past year and a half, but we've seen here in the opening laps of this race, there's been some incidents on the track. I know yourself have also had a tough time with this tricky speedway. What do you think it is about Indianapolis that makes it so tough for you rookie drivers?
I think it's just it's a big track, and all four corners, I believe, are different, and you can get lost around this place pretty easy, and a little mistake here at this big speedway can hurt you really bad, and I think a few incidents on the first lap may have been about the tires and just maybe not being as patient as they need to be. But I'm sure, I mean, everybody's on a learning curve, all these guys, and I still am in the IndyCar Series, so we'll get it figured out.
All right, and again, AJ does turn 19 on next Sunday, which is the Indy 500. Currently, he is qualified in the middle of row 8.
Thank you, Amy. And AJ Foyt, he has started, currently sits 23rd on the grid as we have 24 cars qualified. Now, we're in the third stop of a 12-race Infiniti Pro Series schedule for 2003. So we had the Pikes Peak International Raceway on June 14th, Kansas Speedway. By the way, the series began there last July 7th. So this series only 10 months old. Nashville Super Speedway, Michigan International Speedway, Gateway, Kentucky, Chicagoland, California, and back out to on October 11th, Texas Motor Speedway to finish out the year, the second year for the Indy Racing League Infiniti Pro Series. And what a pretty good schedule it is. Let me get back to what A.J. Foyt, the fourth, said a moment ago. He talks about every corner here being different. Now, for the average fan or the casual fan, looking, the track looks symmetrical. It's two long straightaways and four turns. Are they that much different in the turn?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. When you're out there, all of a sudden, it's literally changed. Believe it or not, turn one, I don't know what the heck happening. As soon as you're approaching turn one, looks like you're going opposite camber. And then you turn, the front grabs, and then the rear starts. You're like, oh, my God, you know, it's kind of really tough. But then in turn two, it depends on the wind. All of a sudden, it's kind of really nice and smooth. Going to turn three, looks like you have more banking. And that's why it feels safer for the drive, feels easier for the drive. Not in case of today that we just have the first yellow happen. And turn four seems to be as well, pretty much as turn three. But so the end of it. Three and four seems to be the easiest part at turn one and two, and it's tough.
If you would share with us, at folks at home, what you did last Sunday in qualifying was unbelievable. I mean, the wind is gusting 30 miles an hour. It's overcast. There's high humidity. It's cold. And you go out late in the day, and you were a very busy camper in that car. Explain to us what happened.
I not even know what happened. No, just kidding. Actually, basically, we did a fantastic job at Team Penske, you know, putting everything together. We wait. The conditions was pretty much like this, except the wind was the opposite. And basically, when you in those situations, you don't want to go and take a chance and qualify right away. So we knew, I knew at least, I wasn't comfortable in the track. So I said, you know what, hold just a minute, guys. Let's take it easy. Let's practice. And when I felt comfortable after like four tentative, you know, attempts, I said, you know what, now let's go. And all of a sudden, man, the car was awesome. But inside the car, I have the bars, I have the weight jacker, you know, all those situations for to fix it. So every corner I was changing to fix the car because of the wind.
Now, you went through turn one and you had it set one way. Before you get to turn two here, you're changing the weight jacker and the bar and everything.
Totally to the opposite, because what happened is the wind was so strong. Basically, one turn only, I was having most of the problem. And if I tried to fix it, like put more front wing or softer front springs, what happened is turn three, turn four, turn one would be terrible. So I wouldn't be able to run. So I took definitely a chance on that. And hey, If you want to take a chance, this is the right place to do it.
So you changed the car in turn two. You changed it back before you got to turn three at 240 miles an hour. You changed it again in turn four so you could handle the car, and you came down for one. That's one lap. You had to do that four consecutive
exactly.
laps.
Exactly. Believe it or not, in that lap particularly that you guys just watching right now, I'm working as I'm making counts in the office. You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, how much we're going to have at the end of the month? I was like, oh my God, how much I'm going to have at the end of this lap? So it was incredible.
And no one can help you. I mean, there's Tim Cindric and all the guys, Rick Runham, and they're all watching. You're the only guy in that cockpit that can make those changes and make those adjustments in the car.
You know what? They do can help. Pray. That's what they're doing. They're praying.
Well, whatever helped you, you did a fabulous job. That
Thank
second
you.
Lap, 232.215 miles per hour. Folks, in a day when many drivers said if it was a practice day, they wouldn't even have taken the car out of the garage, but it happened to be a pole day last Sunday, and Elio Castroneves captured his first pole, giving Roger Penske, by the way, his 12th pole, now even with 12 victories at Indianapolis Motor Speedway, to qualify at a four-lap average of 231.725 miles per hour.
Yeah, for sure, that was incredible.
And shoving your buddy, Tony Kanaan, off the front.
Here we go, just because of the cake that he threw over me right there, you know, on the day before because of the rain out. So that was a great moment, you know. But it ain't over, you know, like I learned the other day. It ain't over until the fellas sing. Is that what they say? I was like, all right, I understand the message, you know. I want to make sure May 25th we get out of here with a big smile on the face.
You have a lot of fun, and that certainly is a lot of fun for your teammates, your teammates. But do you let yourself think about what could happen 8 days from today, that you could make history, that you could be the first three consecutive winner of the Indianapolis 500?
Well, basically, I can't just think about the future. You know, I'm what I'm doing right now, I'm having a lot of fun, as you said. I'm trying to enjoy exactly every second of this moment. And if it means to be, will be, you know. But and if it doesn't mean to be, I mean, if something happened, I at least had a lot of fun.
And you won two in a row. Let's check in where Amy is caught up with our current leader, Ed Carpenter. Amy?
And it was nice of Ed Carpenter to take his helmet off, but usually that's not a good sign when we're in a rain delay. Ed, we've had, what, a couple of green flag laps so far? Any feeling so far about just running this race and trying to get this thing going?
I'd really like to get it in. I mean, we've ran two corners or half the track, both starts, so I guess we've ran one lap under green if you add those two together. And the little bit we've ran, my car's been great, and I just can't. I wish it stopped raining so we get this race on, get the Futaba car out there and get a good run. There's a lot of people here since it's Indy, and just it'd be nice to have a nice sunny race day, but it doesn't look like we're going to get that.
Yeah, not only is it Indy, it's just a few miles from Ed's home. He just lives a couple of blocks here from the Speedway. You see this place every day, and now you're actually racing on the surface. What does that mean to you?
It's awesome. I mean, I've been coming here for so long, and when I decided that I wanted to become a race car driver, this is a place that I dream about and what drives me to succeed. So it's nice to finally be here. I just wish it'd be sunny on our race day.
Yeah, me too. But one more question for you, Ed. 1 week ago, you were graduating from Butler University with a marketing degree. That in itself had to make your mother very proud. Then you come out here, you sit on the pole. I mean, what an emotionally high month for you so far.
Yeah, it's been great. I mean, I'm having all these big moments in my life and all within a week. And it poured down rain on my graduation day, and now it's raining on my parade again today. But we'll just keep our head up, and when we get back to racing, we'll give it all we've got.
All right. Well, that's the beauty of being in Indy in the month of May. It can rain, and then a few minutes later, the sun can come out, so we're not giving up yet.
And we talked about what happened to Ed Carpenter last Saturday. For you youngsters, pay attention. If you want to be a race car driver or want to do anything in life, get your education first. And Ed Carpenter indeed did that. As this home video shows, Butler University, 1 week ago today, he gets a BS degree in marketing and comes back to Indianapolis Motor Speedway, where he is the pole sitter a week later. Ed Carpenter still looking for his first win in this series. Second at Kentucky last year. Finished third in the points. Hoping for that first win to come today. But right now the rains have moved in, and we are under a red flag at Indianapolis. Back in just a moment. Well, RPM today comes your way live from Indianapolis Motor Speedway tomorrow at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time. John Kernel will get you ready for bump day activities. We'll talk to all the drivers, find out who's going to run, who may have a deal for a ride to possibly get into the field. That is RPM today. Of course, updates on NHRA final eliminations at Englishtown and highlights of this Infiniti Pro Series race if we get it started back again at Indianapolis. That's 11:30 a.m. Eastern Time, RPM today. Now let's check in down on the pits where Amy has caught up with a two-time winner this year.
That's right, Jerry, and we had told you that the first two races of the year were your first two ever on the oval track, and then you come to this impressive speedway. What did you think the first time that you set foot on the grounds of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway?
This is a great place, loads of history. It's great to race here. Hopefully you'll be able to get a decent race in. Unfortunately, it's not like that at the moment.
Well, not only is Panther Racing giving you first time on ovals, but now first time up in the spotter stand. I'm understanding so far the month of May, you've been helping out Poncho Carter in the spotting duties for Sam Hornish. What kind of experience has that been for you?
It's been a great experience. You can see all the cars going around, get an idea of the different lines, see how the track changes during the day, and Panther have been able to help me out as far as that's concerned, just get an idea of how what to change on the car, and it probably gave me a little bit of advantage, helped me out for this race and hopefully for the future.
When you're a driver helping a driver, do you feel like that you have a better idea of maybe what Sam might be looking for, and will you have the opportunity to help him during this year's running of the 500?
Hopefully. I don't know. I mean, I've never raced the Indy cars, so they happen a bit quicker, and he probably wants it a little bit earlier, but I try my best. That's all I can do, and hopefully it's good enough. Hopefully I'll be able to help him in the 500.
All right. Well, it's driver turned spotter, but just for this one race, I tell you, Mark Taylor is ready to race here at Indy, and I'm telling you, it's still raining. It's getting harder. We'll see what we can do, guys.
All right. Thank you, Amy. The weather pretty abysmal last Saturday here. It rained out pole day. We had to go for Sunday. There you see the overcast and the rain picking up, and we are being told that spotters have reported some hail in the area. So
wow,
certainly a storm coming in, similar to what we had last Saturday. We are under a red flag condition. There are the safety trucks, the Chevy trucks out on the racetrack for track drying. Our current Infiniti Pro Series point stand is the man you just talked to a moment ago, Amy, is our points leader, Mark Taylor, having won both at Homestead and Phoenix. Tiago Medeiros in second spot, Brandon Irwin in third spot, Jonathan Erlin, Ari Leyendijk Jr., and Matt Beardsley, the top six after two of 12 events on this Infiniti Pro Series schedule. Now, by the way, updating some of the drivers involved in incidents, we are told that Tiago Medeiros and Craig Delansky have both been taken for precautionary x-rays only down the Methodist Hospital. So that those drivers have been taken down for precautionary x-rays. Everyone else appears to be okay. Let's check in once again down with Amy.
Thanks, and we've caught up with Brandon Irwin. He's one of the drivers that's had the least amount of laps on the track so far this month of May. And Brandon, yesterday you didn't even get a chance to qualify. What happened to your car yesterday?
No, we were having trouble, and we had to split the car in half to check, you know, the transmission and the engine, and all the guys at the Sam Schmidt Motorsports, you know, they're working their butts off, and they just couldn't get the car together in time. But I mean, it's together now, and it is hauling the mail. I mean, we're coming. I mean, I picked off two or three guys each time we had a restart. You know, we missed that wreck by just enough. My spotters up there, they saved me on that one. And no, we're going to the front. I think we're going to be very strong. I've picked off guys on every restart. The car feels really strong. And I watch out. I think we're coming to the front. If not today, we'll be up there tomorrow. And they're going to have to contend with me once I get up there.
All right, Brandon. I told you it's still raining down here, guys. They're already talking about tomorrow.
Hey, Jared, that's what I call a positive attitude, huh?
Yeah,
you see, he's ready, man. I tell you, putting rain tires over there, he's about to go.
Brandon is excited. Got a Natural Golf as a sponsor. He didn't get to qualify, but he knew in that final practice session yesterday afternoon he had probably the second or third fastest car in the field. And he said, I'll pass six or seven cars in the very first lap if I get a chance. So he wants this race to get restarted immediately because he's pumped about having a chance.
I'm sure. I can see that. And obviously, if you do have a car, you do have to feel you must have to feel comfortable like that, and it's just a shame, you know, rain now come like this. And do you think you're gonna go today?
Well, you know, I gotta ask you guys, when this happens, when you're all focused and pumped up, when you've got your game face on and you're ready to race, and you're in the car and something like this happens, how difficult is it on a driver to have to sit back and wait now? Can you relax?
Well, I have a perfect example in 2001. I was like 50 laps to go, and the rain came exactly like this. Boom. I was like, great, 50 laps to go. It's more than a half. I'm going to get out of here. I was leading. Perfect. I don't care if people later on are going to say, ah, you just won the race because rain. I said, I don't care.
Win.
All of a sudden, I just saw a little bright spot in the sky. I was like, I guess we're going to have to go back in the car and race. And I tell you, it was very difficult because as soon as you get out of the car, when you go back, it's not the same, you know, because you cool down a little bit, this belt and the seat doesn't seem to be the same, you know, stuff like that. It's very, very difficult. So, but the way it looks out there, man, I don't think you're going to be back racing.
Now, 2 years ago, you led the final 54 laps and won the race. Last year, you led the final 24 laps and won the race. I mean, are you one of these guys sort of just hangs around and waits? I mean, you ran about in the top 12 or 13 all day, and then finally at the end of the race, here comes Elliott.
Hey, the important lap is the last one, so that's what we need to lead. So I don't care if this year we're going to lead the last one. That's going to be important.
Roger Penske has taught you well. Now, this year, your buddy Joe DeFerrin needs to get one. I mean, he hasn't won one yet.
Come on, why? I mean, history about to be making here. Don't you agree, Dave?
Hey, you want to take it any way you can get it. That's right. It doesn't matter if you lead one lap, as long as you lead the last one, that's all that counts.
You know, drivers, you talk about drivers growing up and dreaming about coming to this place. I mean, this guy to my right won in his very first time here. I know, Davey, you ran here a number of times, and every time you come here, even to walk through the gates, if you're a driver, you get the chills.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and I came from a complete different background than Helio did. I raced American short tracks. I was on dirt, pavement, midgets, super modified sprint cars, racing, you know, 40 times a year or sometimes more. And just coming to Indianapolis was my dream. This is I felt if I could make one Indy 500, you know, my racing career was you know, complete, so to speak. But once I came here one time, made the race, was competitive, and then you want more and more and more. And you know, I never have tasted that milk. My best finish is fourth here, runner up in the championship twice, a lot of second place finishes. So, you know, I got to get back to business soon here, hopefully.
This Infiniti Pro Series really is the missing link. I mean, we talk about the fact that guys come from the USAC midgets and Silver Crown and sprint cars, but it's hard to make that jump. It's like flying a Cessna and going to the space shuttle. I mean, you now have that stepping stone to be able to come run the tracks like a Texas and Michigan or this famous track here in a car very similar to what you would run in the higher ranks in the IndyCar series.
Absolutely. One thing that we have in the short tracks, we're front-end race cars. You know, we're used to the engines being in the front, short race tracks, where now this is the car just like the Indy cars. The rear-engine cars, you feel the same in them, they're tubs, they have the same adjustments, it's the same feel. Now you're on the same racetrack. So it's a great stepping stone into the Indy Racing League cars.
And they're very, very safe. As this driver can attest who's standing by with Amy East, Matt Beardsley involved in the very first lap caution. Amy?
Yes, he was. Jerry's got a couple stitches on his chin, but other than that, Matt is doing good physically, that is. Mentally is another question. I know that has to be disappointing to cause the first caution on the first lap, but talk us through it. We have Helio Castroneves and Davey Hamilton that they gave us their expertise on what might have happened. You tell us what happened.
We made some changes yesterday. The car had a little bit of a push. That's the first time I've seen it. It just got a little bit, I think it was just everything was still cold. Either car got up behind me and it took the rear end of the air off the rear end of the car. The car just got a little loose and just went around on me. I tried to get on the brakes to where it didn't hit the wall quite as hard, but it still hit pretty good.
Saying that you saw this for the first time, thanks to our monitor here, as we're all standing out in the rain, did you have any feeling whatsoever that the entire rear end had ripped out from the back of your car?
After I hit, I spun around and I looked up and I thought it was another car, and I could see the 12 on the infence going, oh man, it was a good one. I could see the thing bouncing and rolling down the track, but it was definitely a good one.
Brandon, what does this do? I'm sorry, Matt, what does this do for you and the team, having crashed on the first lap and just the spirits of the entire team? I mean, this is very early in our entire season.
Well, since we did so well qualifying, I mean, just a major dream to be here. I think we'll be okay. The car's not as bad as we thought it was. They're looking at it, and I think we'll be able to be okay.
All right. Well, Dr. Jerry Punch, you said it best. Safety, definitely a key factor here, especially for Matt Beardsley. He is okay.
And give a call to all the engineers involved with this series. They have certainly brought these cars to bear in a very safe configuration. Back with more Under a Rain Delay at Indianapolis in just a moment. Stay with us. ESPN Speed World coverage continues at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Brought to you by Firestone, America's tire since 1900. Well, we are under a rain delay here. The rains have moved in and some hail overhead, so we have taken the cars back to the garage area. Just 12 laps are complete, and this inaugural Freedom 100 Infiniti Pro Series event. And let's check in now where Amy has caught up with another driver. Amy?
Thanks, Jerry. I've caught up with Corey Witherall. He came into the month of May one of only three drivers with previous experience here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. 2001, you qualified for that Indy 500, and we're getting dripped on big. Don't laugh at me now. You had done the Indy 500. Did you feel as though that was going to be a big advantage for you coming into this Pro Series race?
Yeah, I think it's going to be definitely a huge advantage just because, you know, the month of May is not so much trying to get the speed, but it's also, you know, trying to deal with the distractions. You know, there's so much of a tradition for, like, the last, you know, 87 running of this race, and here we are in the Pro Series, the first one. You know, that just the media attention it's getting with, you know, being part of the 500 month. And my experience of that, you know, I know what I need to do. I know how to stay mentally focused and just concentrate what I need to do. And I know the track. And even though it's 40 miles an hour slower, but I actually got to realize a lot more things about the track than I didn't realize before, you know, like little things about the corners. And so I still learning each time. So the next time I come back in a big car, you know, I have a lot more knowledge.
Okay, well, keep a look eye on this guy, Corey Witherall. I have a feeling when we do get this race started, he's definitely going to be a contender.
And Corey Witherall ran the 2001 Indy 500, became the first Native American full-blooded Navajo to run at Indianapolis. He finished 19th on that day. That's Al and Candela's Indy Regency racing team. But right now, today, guys, the rains have moved in, so we are going to try to get this Infiniti Pro Series race started later in the day if the weather permitting. If not, we'll update you on RPM today and, of course, our coverage tomorrow. But, Elio, I want to thank you so much for coming and being a part of our telecast. I know you got a busy month of May and a lot to think about.
I hope I wasn't a bad luck here. You know, the rain came out. He's talking. I'm sorry. I tried to do my best here. I'm sorry if I made a mistake on the name, stuff like that. I'm still learning. One day I'll learn.
Yeah. ESPN, the magazine, by the way, 20 sexiest athletes in the world, Elio Castroneves. We're in there too, Davey, with people who know Elio Castroneves. But Davey Hamilton, these drivers, I have to think about even for another day possibly getting this race finished in Indianapolis.
Absolutely, and that's difficult. 1997, we came here, it took us 3 days to run the Indianapolis 500. We ran a few laps, it rained, we had to go a whole another day, you go through your whole routine again, get back in the car, it's very difficult. So these guys want to get this race over with today, and hopefully it happens.
12 of 40 laps are completed at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Elio, we wish you the best of luck coming a week from tomorrow. I know you're going to go out and run some full tank runs, but then thinking about what could happen on May 25th, the first driver ever to possibly win three consecutive Indianapolis 500s.
Stop putting pressure, man. You keep putting pressure. I can't believe it, man. Oh, boy.
But
hopefully.
But you're cooler on the other side of the pedal.
No, that's
you're
right.
Okay.
As soon as you close the visor, step pedal to the metal.
All right, we'll be back here with live coverage tomorrow of Bubble Day, of Bump Day. It's the final qualifying day for Indianapolis Motor Speedway. As we will fill the field at 1 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN, then coverage on ABC Sports. Paul Page, Bob Jenkins and company over there at 4 Eastern time. Back here for the final hour, 6 o'clock Eastern time, Indy 500 Bump Day, to fill the field for the 87th running of the Indianapolis 500. Coming up next, Major League Soccer from Invesco Field in Denver, Colorado. Well, the rains are coming out of Indianapolis. It was a history-making day, at least to get the cars on the track here, because in 1911, Ray Haroon won the first Indy 500. In 1994, Jeff Gordon won a NASCAR event here. In 2000, Michael Schumacher. And we were hoping for a new winner today at Infiniti Pro Series, but it wasn't to be because the weather's moved in. Thanks again to our special guest, Elio Castroneves. So long, everyone, from Indianapolis Motors.